At the Knowledge Exchange for Resilience at Arizona State University, we tackle extreme challenges like climate change, social disruption, and economic insecurity within a three-part framework: share, discover, solve.
We had a very robust data set. And for us as providers, sometimes we don't know the right questions to ask or even the ways in which we can really extrapolate those insights from the metrics that we're gathering. So when I think about ASU, ASU needs to be at the table because it's one of the preeminent learning institutions in the state. But more importantly, think about all of these students that go to ASU. Many of these students come from communities in which we are actively working to serve.
When we put together this challenge of building a knowledge exchange for resilience, we were asking the question, resilient against what? What is the big threat, the big issue that Maricopa County is facing? And of course here, heat is one of the major issues that we decided that we needed to help our community prepare for. One of the things that we could do by bringing all the partners together, by bringing the data together, and really truly getting a bird's eye view of all of those systems across the silos, across the different sectors, that helped us understand what we were missing. Where are the vulnerabilities that we don't have programming for? Where do we need to act to move the needle? And where is this all going?
We did all of this work knowing the trends that we're seeing right here so that more households and families don't have to negotiate life and death in the summer. So for us, it's coming together to really be able to make this process more efficient so that folks can actually get connected to the services they need at their most urgent time of need. People don't die.
So when you overlay that information, where are people receiving utility assistance and the resources to deal with heat? And on the other hand, you see the locations where people are suffering and dying because of the heat. That gap between where the need is and where our resources are going really drew our attention. What is happening there? Why are we not making it? What is this blind spot? What did we miss?
You can see the data trend that's moving closer to Mesa, extended out toward the East Valley, where you go, well, duh, something must be happening out there.
When you zoom in closer and you see that a lot of that gap was happening in places where people live in mobile and manufactured housing, it really clicks.
But then considering that there's such a lack of resources in that space, people are dying, right? And if there's no entity that is actively pointing these issues out, then we just go on life as usual in the summer, hear about the heat-related deaths and go, oh, that must be a shame.
Unidades y poder decirles, aquí hay algo para ti. Aquí es este el camino que vamos a seguir, que vamos, porque como repito, soy parte de su comunidad, soy parte de esas necesidades y de ese apoyo. Entonces, yo quiero seguir apoyándoles, queremos seguir al frente de ellos para seguir ese camino donde van a encontrar esa solución que están buscando.
This is a community that is burdened by pretty severe invisibility, marginalization, lack of access to resources, that even those of us who brought resources to bear, that the fit was not right. So basically things were not happening. So they're just oftentimes kind of left out on the margins.
Dinos a dónde vamos, qué hacemos, cómo buscamos. Y eso es parte de lo que se valora. Ellos están listos para aprender, para conocer y descubrir, pedir y unirse a esta búsqueda de recursos.
Porque aquí es inmediatamente dice, no, es que este año ha sido más difícil para mí con el año.
The next step after understanding that big picture was to validate what we were seeing, to ask people how do they manage the heat? What types of effects do they see on their health? What types of costs do they incur because of trying to manage the heat? Where did they fall between the cracks? What kind of resources did they use? These were all the kinds of questions that we needed to know from people on the ground. We would really like to understand how we can weatherize some of our older mobile homes in Maricopa County, where we can fix up some of the solutions, put in place maybe some skirts to keep the heat from coming inside the lower part of the home, how we can weatherize windows, how we can get electric back to people who maybe are having a lack of access to electricity.
Pero para el calor, definitivamente las plantas son una herramienta fundamental.
A lo mejor de repente no tan buena suerte de que se le descompongan o en la calor no, como...
Oh, sí, se va descompuesto.
¿Sí? ¿El costo de electricidad? Muy alto, ¿qué?
Pues no. Sí. Sí, en tiempo de verano pagamos como 360.
Wow. Wow. Es este...
Previously, we were not seeing these flyers and water bottles and this information being distributed inside of trailer parks because it's private property. It's personal property, not real property. And so they can't access some of the mortgage and financial instruments that other types of homeowners have. They're not always direct customer of the utilities. They might own the unit that they live in, but they rent the lot, and then they pay the electrical bill to the park owner. So they may not get some of those benefits directly from the utility provider. Also, federal LIHEAP dollars are not eligible for the structures because they are on wheels. Even if they're covered with a skirt, even if they're not truly mobile, mobile and manufactured homes are not always eligible for the LIHEAP dollars or the weatherization dollars that the city might be giving. You also see in some parks that the surface that units are placed on is impervious. So it doesn't lend itself very well to those wonderful tree programs where you can plant a tree to create shade.
There is no lack of opportunity to help to create the conditions so that people can live safer, healthier, and more socially cohesive lives, which is what makes the kind of community that we all want to live in.
I'm Patricia Sunya. I head up the Neighborhood Watch Program for the park. I'm with the Homeowners Association.
Also the movie tour guide today. So talk to me a little bit about why people choose to live in a mobile home and manufactured parks, and you know what kind of people live.
If you go out and rent an apartment in somewhere, it's going to cost you probably much more than it does here.
So it is affordable housing for many families,
right. And you're not going to know anybody. Everybody's going to be working around you, and you're going to be all by yourself. Here you have your neighbors, we have parties, this morning we had coffee and donuts in the hall. So we had probably, I would say, over 200 people there this morning. And so you get to see everybody and talk and visit. I love it here.
The problem is then when we start talking about the heat, for those who stay, and that's one thing you and I have been talking about for a couple of years, actually. And then you'll see things like this. This is a nice shade over here to try to...
See, now these are the nice trees that are still working, you know, still living here. And that provides a lot of shade for the place.
And there's some solutions that people have been trying to put in place. But as the summer gets hotter, like last year, we were really worried about people because of the pandemic that says you have to stay in your home.
Yep.
And then
weren't able to get out and stuff. They can't have coolers anymore.
Oh yeah?
They aren't allowed to have a cooler. They have to have air conditioning. And so I think that's helped a lot. First day I met you, you came to our annual meeting in Tucson when you were starting up your project, and you latched on to me.
I said, I need to know what you know. That's right.
So that's how we met.
Now we're in the third year of dealing with this, and every time I talk to you, I learn something new.
Well, I don't have that much more knowledge. We better not talk too much more.
So is there anything in the Landlord Tenant Act that deals with heat?
No, I don't think so. And we are here to help people. That's our purpose. So I think, you know, it's all about protecting us when we live in these parks and stuff. Yeah.
By starting together in the right place, when we get those answers and we try to design those solutions, we already have the community together with us to put them in place. So that when we start making those investments, we've already identified which are the right questions to answer and where to put those investments. And then we get more than just the answers to those questions, more than just the solutions to those problems. We get the dividends of the partnerships, of the data that we share, and of the solutions being really well adapted to the problems that we're facing together.
It's 110 outside. It can be 125 in your home, especially if it's a mobile home and it's metal. The longer term solution for making mobile homes more viable in Arizona is weatherization.
I love this shade that you got here.
Isn't that beautiful?
It's perfect.
It's only taken 12 years, 15 years.
That's right. Can I come on in? Hi.
Who's your vehicle?
How are you? Oh, we walked over. It's just a couple of blocks over.
Oh, from Sue's?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Come on up.
Yeah.
I got solar screen. This is a solar screen here, the window, a solar panel on the inside of the window. And I got their front windows and these windows over here and the bathroom window.
South side.
They're all solar. But, you know, you get to the point where you think you're going to save energy, and then the utility bills go up. I had a friend of mine that went and applied for subsidy of the utilities. He couldn't get it.
But there's and some programs have different cutoffs than other programs, right?
Yeah, there's people in here that I know they can't afford a pot to pee in. But, you know, they gotta find their way.
We discovered that people who live in these parks are falling between the cracks of the programs that they have to have people with heat. We want people to live happy, long lives, and the heat really does exacerbate the problem. I'm at ASU, and I'm about data and knowledge and information. And I'm trying to get the best information among to try to move and mobilize the people who have the resources to do the right things.
These things are poorly built in the first place. And they could withstand the heat down here if they were built properly. I was living on my own in a county island and had a double wide. And just one room, all I did was the windows. And those were triple pane. Two windows, triple pane, and it dropped it 20 degrees in that one room. And I didn't even touch the roof yet, which had to be done.
Have you put some stuff in place to try to, well, I mean, you have some nice shades here.
Yeah. But I need new windows, and I can't afford them. I got to have somebody check my roof. I can't afford that. Yeah, I make too much money for everything else, but I still can't afford a lot of things.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, right there in that crack.
I'm right in that crack where I can, And so I do know that I could use some help with some windows. And I'm sure a lot of the other people in my park have the same problem. We need it, but we can't afford it.
So would you ever consider leaving the park life?
Not unless I have to. Mm-hmm. Oh, no. This is my home. Minnesota's not my home anymore. This is my home. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Oh, that's great. I hear that so much.
Yes, I love it.
I don't know how some people do it. I really don't. I mean, our air conditioner for the time we're here is running almost 24/7. Okay, we have an older one. So many people obviously are on a budget. Okay, and how they can afford that. You know, the insulation in the homes are not great. The park doesn't like us to put the silver stuff in the windows. That affects the homeowner. And so many things there, you know, cost is a huge, huge thing. I don't know how a lot of people do it over the summer. Mm-hmm. And I know a lot of people can't do it over the summer, but they have no choice. It's hard enough paying their electric bill. You know, they have a hard time paying that. You know, let alone trying to do other things that can help keep down the electric cost.
Right.
You know, I mean, help is needed out there.
Yeah, yeah.
The ideal thing to me would be replacing windows and or old air conditioning units. Is that feasible? I don't know. Okay, the cheaper way would be at least putting these screen or tinted windows on all the houses. You know, I'm sure for most people, yeah, I'll take the more expensive if it's free, you know, but nothing's for free. You know, we all got to pay a little bit for something, and hopefully you guys can help us out with that. And
yeah, I hope so too. In the short run, we want to make sure that people today are being protected from the high temperatures that we're seeing every summer. So we want to make sure that right now, today, people understand what the risks are and that they know where they can go for help. In the mid-range, we would really like to understand how we can weatherize some of our older mobile homes in Maricopa County. The tools that we have right now that might need a little bit more investment can be put in place for the hundreds of thousands of Arizona residents who are living in mobile manufactured homes and need shelter from the heat. In the long run as well, we need to think about how we build our cities. Maricopa County is the fastest growing county in the United States for many years in a row. We want to continue to see economic growth, but we have to also provide for the housing for our residents. To do that, we need to make sure that our mobile manufactured housing sector is viable. We want to make sure that people can continue to own their own homes, but do so in a way that protects them from the growing heat. It's very significant that we're asking of ourselves as a university and of our community partners, what should we be doing to make sure that they're not falling between the cracks?
What we really need to do is we need to change our design logic. The design logic now needs to assume that continuous innovation related to resilience will be required for anything that we confront. We need every tool we can possibly bring to bear through a network like CUR can build on how to exchange knowledge and learning to make better decisions related to resilience, and that's unbelievably important in the evolution of ASU, because we're no longer a selfish, moated, sequestered, force field guarded institution of higher education that is not interested in broader solutions. We're ready to go, and CUR is really how we're doing that.
Despite the many efforts to support heat resilience, as a result of the design of our systems, the people who needed assistance the most were among the least likely to get it. It took a new logic of engagement, intense study, and novel data analysis to reveal these hidden vulnerabilities. We aim to innovate a new design logic to solving problems. We hope to be one of the most outstanding mechanisms for how ASU is realizing its institutional commitment to take fundamental responsibility for the economic, social, cultural, and overall health of the communities we serve. Share, discover, solve. That's our approach. Together, we are making a difference in Maricopa County by growing our capacity to turn extraordinary shocks and stresses into new opportunities to adapt, prosper, and grow.